All right, so let's get started here. So here is the current scene. I'm going to go up to the window menu and look at my scenes. Scene panel. You might want to have that one open because I'm going to be jumping from scene to scene. So you can go up to the window menu, scene. And I'm on S3, front door. We're at the front door. And what we've done here is have the ability that if the person clicks on the door doesn't open, it just kind of wiggles. So what we want is for the window to be our way in. We need to set up a rock or a pipe or something on the floor to open the window. We'll do that in a moment. But the window is going to behave like how the gate behaved back on S2, scene 2. Remember, the gate is a movie clip which has, you know, frame 1 is it closed, and frame 5 is the door open. We're going to do something similar for the window, one of these windows. I'm going to just choose the window on the right. I'm going to make the window on the right into a movie clip, and scene 1 will be the window normal. I mean, frame 1 will be the window normal, and frame 5 will be the window broken. Then we're going to add the code that once the window breaks, we can proceed to the next scene. So let's start setting up our window first. I'm on scene 3. Select your right window, and let's turn it into a symbol. So I'm selecting my drawing of the window on the right. Press F8, which converts it into a movie clip. Let's call this MC Window Right. Again, MC because it's a movie clip. We might do something, you might figure out something fun to do with the left window as well. Maybe the left window takes you to a completely different route. So then I would create MC window left. I've got right window, left window. It's a movie clip. As soon as it becomes a movie clip, let's go ahead then and also give it an instance name. That's very easy to forget. If it doesn't have an instance name, then we can't use code to do anything with it. So then that would be window right underscore MC. So the symbol has a name and the instance of it on the stage has a name. Window right MC. We're then going to double click the window to make a few edits. So either double click it on the stage or double-click it in your library. The difference is, if you never noticed this, if you double-click a symbol in your library, we then focus our stage only on the symbol. But if we double-click it on the stage, it shows it to us in context, meaning I can still see what else is in the scene. So if you double-click it on the stage, the rest of it fades out, it's still there. If you double-click it in the library, we only focus on the symbol. There's no right or wrong way, but sometimes it's useful to do one or the other. What I want to do then is, we will first create our actions layer. So right now I'm editing the right window. And I've got a new layer, actions. And the first command I want is stop, because we're going to have the window untouched and then the window broken. Double click your movie clip of the window, create a new layer called actions. I'll press F9 to open up the Actions panel. That's the shortcut. F9 opens up your Actions, and we'll type the Stop command. So mine's taking a moment to think about it, but hopefully it will. I'll type the Stop command. there we go. So I have my actions panel open. I'm in my movie clip of window right, frame one, stop. Okay, so similar to the gate, I then want it open, but in our case broken. So at frame 5, we'll create a new, we'll copy the keyframe, so F6 on your assets layer, F6, so that you can redraw the window in a broken way. I'm going to go over to frame 5 of my assets layer. Obviously, I've renamed it. It was called layer 1, but we should be in the habit of calling a layer assets and another layer actions. So F6 to copy the keyframe so that then I can redraw. Well, actually, sorry, before I F6, I'm going to fill in the colors. If you haven't done so yet, I should fill in those colors because then the area where it's actually clickable is very, very small. It's only the lines. So on your window, on my window, I'm filling in a color as well. Now there's a spot where I can click, where the user can click to interact. Then I'll press F6. On frame 5, and then I'll redraw it, broken, like, you know, jagged glass and such. So we'll go to frame 5, F6. I'm going to redraw the window. The way I'll draw this is I'm going to color on top of what's already there, so that I can redraw it. Right, I'm coloring what's there, so then I can redraw broken glass. Something like that. So frame 1, the window is intact, and then frame 5, the window is broken. Exactly as what we did with the gate before, then, we want to show this in this state for a moment. And then we're going to have code to take us to scene 4. So we did it on frame 50. Let's extend the assets to 50. I think we went to 50. We go to 50, so F5 for frame 50 on the assets layer. We want it to be visible as a broken window for a little while. We then add a blank keyframe on actions layer so that we can add new code. So the blank keyframe lets us add new code at that point in time. After the window is visibly broken for a moment, then we will go to scene 4. So switch to frame 50 of your actions layer. Code for that to go next is very similar to the gate. So let's see, actions layer, frame 50, and here we're going to have movie clip, capital M, capital C, parentheses. Inside the parentheses, this dot root, we saw this before. This is basically saying, let's manipulate the root of the movie clip. Let's do something on the main timeline, basically. Dot go to and play. The arguments here are 1, comma, and then in quotes the name of the next scene, which will be S4 Hall. We're going to go into the hallway now. The window gets broken. Once it gets broken, let's take us to the hallway.
Could it be the entry rather from the hallway?
Possibly. Any of these names will work. Entry, entrance. Yeah, we can call these whatever we want. Yeah, let's call that entry. That makes sense. Entry, entrance, whatever. So we've got that. All right, so after we break the window, we're in the entryway. After that, we can then proceed. After we get into the entryway, that's where we're going to branch off. Question?
Oh, it just means
so once we get into this scene, the entry scene, then we will be able to branch off. We could branch off at any point, of course, but it makes sense for me that we're in the entryway, and then we have, okay, left hall, right hall. So then we will go off in different directions. So at a certain point in our game, in your project, you'll be able to branch off in as many directions as you want, and we'll see how to do that in a moment. But we're still getting past our first challenge, which is now we need to break the window. So make sure you've got that code. And then what we'll do is we'll go back to the main scene, go back to the timeline. So you can press the back arrow on the top left, and we'll go back to the main scene, back to front door. And we've got the window, which has been prepared. It's got the code that will take us to the next scene. So now, let's draw a rock, or a pipe, or a samurai sword, or whatever, on the floor. And we're going to use that as something that we're going to pick up to then break the window.
Show the code again.
Okay, sure. So go ahead then on your on the floor there, on the assets layer. I'm just going to draw a super simple rock. We need to turn the rock into a symbol, and then we will write some code in just one moment. So then, all right, so in front door, I'm going to draw a rock on the floor. Frame 1 in the assets layer of your front door scene.
Should have capital E.
So there's a rock. I need to then select that rock that I drew, turn it into a symbol.
F8
to turn it into a symbol, I'll call it MC Rock. And then instance name, don't forget the instance name. That rock, I turned it into a symbol. It's on the scene. Instance name, rock underscore MC. It's a symbol. It's got an instance name. I'm gonna fill in the color. Yes.
The movie clip in the code should be blue, right?
Say that again? Yeah, movie clip, the word movie clip. It's capital M, capital C, movie clip. All right, so I've got a rock. So I've got a rock, and it's on the scene, and it's got a name. So we've got the rock, it's on the scene, it's got an instance name. Let's look at our actions panel then to do the hit detection. It's going to be more complex than we've written before because we need to write code to be able to pick up the rock, number one. We need to then write code to say, well, don't move the rock completely off of the screen, so we need to create a bounding box. Then we need to create code to have it detect this movie clip touched this movie clip. So this is going to be a little bit more coding. And it works like this. So first of all, we need to add an event listener to the rock so that we can actually manipulate it. Go back to your code here, and we have rock underscore mc dot add event listener. You might want to maybe copy and paste from the top, or just practice listener touch event dot touch tap comma something fn go hall. This is going to be our function that goes into the hallway. We call it entry, didn't we? Never mind. Entry, whatever we call it. So the rock now is going to be movable, or actually simply it's going to react to touch. Touch tap makes sense if we're going to tap it one time to do something, but this is going to be a little bit different. We're going to touch it and hold it to move it. Especially, what's that?
Touch hold.
So, something like that. It's going to be touch begin. Because technically, when you tap something and you drag it and such, there's a moment where you begin touching it, and then a moment you let go of touching it. So we'll have a touch begin and a touch end. So now we're getting more complex. Not just a touch tap. We have to hold onto the object and then let it go. We have a touch begin. On the next line, well, let's make a little comment right above here to note for ourselves. Code to begin to pick up the rock. Next line, we're defining the function, fn go entry. Similar to what we've got at the top, this is an event. Touch event returns void. So this is just the way we do it. So we're defining that function, which we've said here, go entry, something's going to happen. So as I said, we're going to pick it up to move it around, but we could accidentally move this completely off the screen. So we have to create a bounding box the size of the screen so we don't go too far out. Let's back up one line before that. And let's create a new variable, var. We'll call this rock drag bound. We are bound to this area. We cannot move the rock past a certain area. Using this, we are going to define, well, you can't move it past the whole screen. But using this, if you get creative later on, you can set this up to create a bounding box that is only a few pixels wide. So this object can only be moved a little bit from where it originally was. This bounding box, rock drag bound.
This is a colon rectangle. Notice it's a capital R.
So we're going to draw a rectangular shape.
Yes, we could draw a triangular one or a circular one, etc., but this one will be simple because right now our device is a rectangle. We want to make a box that encompasses the whole thing. It's a rectangle, the whole screen. Space equals new space rectangle. Open and close parentheses.
So we're creating a bounding box, which is going to be the whole screen. So we're creating a rectangle of some certain dimensions, which we'll fill in right here, which will be right here, which then we will use right here. Let's be able to move our rock, but only inside of the bounding box.
Rock drag boundary might make more sense. Let's change that. Rock drag boundary.
This is the boundary that we can drag the rock. Obviously, we can change these things whatever we want.
We can change these things however we want. We just need to be consistent with our names here. Inside the rectangle, we'll type 0, comma, 0, comma, stage. Yes?
Why don't you have the import flash events touch and rectangle above?
It may appear for you. It may not. We've already done that back on like frame one on scene one. So we don't need it. If it's there, you can leave it alone. It shouldn't affect you, but if you want to add it, that's fine.
That's bothered.
Yeah. Stage width, comma, stage dot stage height.
We're creating a rectangle that starts on the top left corner of the screen, 0, 0. And then we're stretching it out to as wide as the stage. And we're stretching it down as tall as the height. So we've got a box as big as the whole screen of the device, be it this one that I have here, this, you know, 4-inch device or whatever, or your Nexus, or your Kindle. We're making a box as big as the whole screen. So obviously, if we wanted to make a box that was only a certain size, we put something like, don't change this, but we could put something like 123, comma, 222, comma, 555, comma, 111, or 777, or something. Don't change it. But what I'm saying here is, we're making, in this case, a box that starts on the, from the top, we move to the right, 123 pixels, and we move down, 222. And then we make a box that further extends down. So we can make an area, a certain position in our project that is at a certain coordinates. Let's leave what I had before. I'm just showing as an example that if you wanted to make a box in a certain place, we can define its coordinates. Let's leave what I had here. The whole screen.
So let's make a note above that. Make a bounding box of the whole screen to keep the rock inside of.
So first line up here, we're going to start to move a rock. Second line here, we're going to move it only between certain dimensions. And then over here, well, what happens is we start to move it.
Now remember, the other door is always open over there, Sarah, so you can always come in through the other door, which is always open. That one's locked for security. That's okay. Okay, so next, inside of the FN go entry, this is when we start to say, well, let's move this thing around. Okay, so inside of function go entry, event.target dot start touch drag. open and close parentheses.
So now here's a command that is saying dot target. This current thing that I've clicked on is our target. This rock is our target. There's an event happening upon the current target. The event is we start to drag it. So the actual command to drag it is this, but our setup are those previous lines. Inside of event, or touch drag, we have event dot touch point ID. This is just some little internal thing that is about, well, where did we touch the rock to start to move it? Where is the point where we've touched the rock? Our finger touched the object at a certain point. That's the identification of the touch point. Comma, false. Notice my tip here is telling me your first item is your touch point, comma, locked to center, comma, and the balance. Right here we're saying, what is that one saying? That one is if you touch the rock, if you touch it in the corner, it's not going to jump to be in the center of where you touched. It's wherever you touch the rock, you will move the rock. So if I touch the rock right here, I'm going to move the rock. It's not going to be that I touch the rock here and then it centers to there. So it's like a little internal thing. Don't even worry about it. We'll just put false. Don't reposition the rock that I touched. Keep it where I touched it. Comma, the bounding box, which we just called a moment ago, rock drag boundary. So now we've got an area of where can we move that rock? Anywhere on the whole screen and not outside of it. Okay, so that's all of the code just to get it to move. After I let go of the rock, that's when I'm going to do hit detection. So I need to do an event listener, touch end, to actually go forward. So next, so go to the very end. Make sure you go after your function of go entry. We're going to do again rock underscore mc dot add event listener. Another touch event. This time touch end. So here I had the idea above to name this go entry. It doesn't actually go to the entry yet. This is just about starting to drag my rock. So this can be named to something like function start drag rock, function stop drag rock. So again, these names, the blue text and the purple text obviously is reserved code that is ActionScript code. The black text is code that we invent, names of things. So it might be better to change these two names up here. This isn't actually going to the entry yet. This is just dragging the rock. Let's go back and change it. Function start drag rock. Function start drag rock. Here then, what would that be? Function stop drag rock.
Function start drag rock.
If you don't change these, that's fine, but I would function start drag rock.
I'm actually uploading the screenshots to Discord right now.
Cool.
Yes, if you guys open up the Discord, Link, go to CIS126 snippets, code snips, and I'm actually uploading the camera screenshots up there.
Oh, thank you. So function start drag rock, function start drag rock, function stop drag rock.
I'm gonna make it.
Well, I opened it to everyone.
So now we're dealing with when we let go of the rock, we have to have a function to deal with stop, drag, rock. Next line, function stop, drag, rock. Event touch event colon void something very similar then goes down here. Event target stop touch drag. Event dot target dot stop touch drag with parentheses. Inside the parentheses, we're saying event dot touch point ID and nothing else. We don't care about the bounding box anymore. Boundary right here. We don't need it down here anymore. We're just stop dragging it. Let's make a couple of comments and then we can test it. I'm going to back up to the start drag and say start dragging. Well, you can say drag the rock within the boundaries of the screen. And in this very last line, stop dragging the rock.
Comment mark.
Nope, oh, one more. Yes. All right, so at this point, I think we can test it. Go ahead and save it, publish it to your device. Or if you don't have a device, do Control Enter and test it that way. But at the very least, what we'll be able to do is start to drag the rock. It's not going to break the window yet. But we should be able to at least start to see that we can pick up the rock and move it. If we get any errors, of course, this is the time for you to call us over to figure out your errors. If your pop-up at the bottom of your output tells you some error, right, call us over. But let me test out mine. You're going to have to, again, do your publish settings and all of that. Be with you one moment up there. If you're using my certificate, remember this P12 file. If you're using my P12 file, the password is Victor. That window's going to be in the way there, but hopefully you can kind of see the code.
Just
sometimes my windows get in the way. Sorry about that. Let me zoom back into the code.
Yeah, I need to see line 14.
Just one moment, let me finish up with that.
When I try to go to publish, just says this.
Typos. Expecting colon before dot. Double click on that first one. Double click on this. It automatically has.
Thank you.
proceed.
Like,
sure you're not distracted during this class.
Why can't you get back?
Because there's so many little things.
Yeah, you should be able to.
Okay. What was the option again?
Huh?
What was the option to go?
Option?
Yeah, like which are the icons at the top? Like.
What do you mean?
Which option?
Show me.
No, I mean which option is you want to.
Oh, it should be published.
Yeah.
This is our code. Obviously, you know, this took a little bit of setup, as we're seeing, but this is the nature. So the nature of this is that we have all of this code that we need to write, and this is a small app. We're getting there. We're setting it up so that we are able to pick up the rock. So I didn't test it on mine, but a quick test. I go to start. I open the door opens, click on the front door. It doesn't want to go, but if I pick up the rock, I can move a rock. So now comes the hit detection. I'm going to move the rock and put it on the window so that we break the window. So that means we need to write some code inside of stop drag. Once we've stopped moving the rock, let's detect. Did the rock touch the window? So after we say here, stop dragging the rock, next line, we're going to create this if else this if-else block. So, notice the way it's typed. We have the if parentheses curly brace, next line, close curly brace, else curly brace, curly brace. Be careful there. Just because you see one curly brace doesn't mean it's right. It has to be these pairs. When you have these symbols that are easy to lose track of, one thing that we could do is start to make notes like this. End of if else. This is just a comment. But this is a good comment to have here to explain to us. This is where this ends. This one over here, I might make a comment. End of function stop drag rock. Because I'm going to lose track so easily of these symbols. Make sure you've got an ending curly brace for the whole function, of course. And you've got an ending curly brace for this else. Ending and closing here. This is an if-else statement. I'll make a note above the statement saying, if else to check if something happened. So, we did something like this the very first time we looked at looping the on the very first day that we did ActionScript, remember, we did a loop, and it was counting. And once we had 7 loops, we stopped. Well, we can do if-else for the same sort of thing, because in the real world, you know, if I decide to go have something to eat, internally, I'm thinking, if I'm hungry, I will go eat, or else I'm not hungry, so I won't eat. That's what we're doing here in computer language. If something happens, do the following code, and then we can have 1,000 lines of code right here between those curly braces. If something happens, do the following. Or else it didn't happen. Or else it didn't happen, so do the following. Here's how we can make 2 simple choices. We can get more complex and make 3 choices, where we have if else, and then else if. We check another thing. Is it this? Is it this? Is it this? So we can make choices. The choice that we're going to do, this is where the hit detection will happen. If there is hit detection, do the following. If there isn't hit detection, do something else. So inside of the parentheses, we're going to say rock_mc.hitTestObject. Parentheses. We have a command that will let us test hit detection on objects. So again, there's 200 commands that are built in. I don't need to know them all, but I need to be able to look them up. And this actually comes from the... most of these that I'm showing you here come from the code snippets. Remember when we looked at code snippets and it wrote the code for us? We're doing it the hard way. We're doing it the way that we're writing all the code ourselves. And the point of that is because code snippets are useful to do it quickly, but you perhaps are not quite learning anything. If we're doing it manually, yeah, we're making mistakes, but mistakes help us. The mistakes of, oops, I forgot to capitalize. The mistake of, oops, I misspelled it. The mistake of, I put it in the wrong spot. Mistakes are good. Don't get discouraged if you're getting a lot of mistakes. They help us understand what went wrong and what to improve. So there's a command to detect if this object touches another object. The other object, in the parentheses, is the window. What did we call the window's instance name? Window write MC, I think. Let me double check. I forget these things too. What did we call it? Window write MC, yes. So check that out. We are saying, on the rock, let's detect if we hit the window.
Oh, the rock. So I think the window.
What's that? So we've got the rock, it's got an instance name. We've got the window, it's got an instance name. And we're detecting if we actually hit the window. Well, the point of that is if we hit the window, then we want the window to play so that the animation of it breaking happens. And remember, on frame 50 of the window, there is the actual command that says, take us to scene 4. So we'll say window write mc dot play. Play the movie clip. We've got the movie clip of the window set to stop on frame 1. And so it continues to play. Now, once it gets to frame 50, it hits the part that said, go to and play scene 4, which doesn't exist yet. Under else, we don't really need to deal with else. Either we hit the window or we didn't. If we didn't hit the window, then do nothing at all. But it's useful for us to do this command here, trace. Trace gives us a message in the output panel. Not the regular person, they won't see this. A trace gives us a message. Where you get your errors, we can give ourselves a message. In quotes, we'll say anything we want. Didn't hit the window. So trace commands go to the output panel. They are messages for us. Detect if the rock hit the window, then play the window movie clip. Which then takes us to scene 4. Entry.
So if you're not getting all those comments, don't worry about it. They're just comments. My comments will be in the code when I give it to you at the end of the day. The important part, of course, are the parts that are not comments. So make sure that that stuff works. So don't stress too much that you didn't type what I typed in the comments. Make sure, however, you type the right commands. In order for this to fully work, we need a scene 4. So before you test this, create a scene 4. Put some happy face there or something, just so that we see it go there. And remember, if we've got a new scene, it needs a stop at the beginning of the first frame of scene 4. So that's the code to start to do that, to be able to use the rock on the window. Hit detection. Use dot hit test object to check if two objects touched. If you want to talk about three objects touching and all of that, don't even ask at the moment. That's too advanced. This is just two objects touching at the moment. Okay, again, if you haven't typed the comments, don't worry about it, I'm moving on. I need to create a new scene. Scene 4 entry. I'll draw a real entryway in a moment. I'm just going to draw a happy face so I have something to see. But I need the actions layer where I can stop it. Create a new scene, scene 4 entry, and then stop the play of the scene 4. Then you can test it and check it out. So then test it and try to pick up that rock and hit the window and see if it goes to the new scene. Let me check if mine works, and then I'll put my code back up. One moment. My window blocks all my code. Just wait one moment. So once that publishes, I should be able to have the rock touching the window.
Just try to test the things.
Yep, let me just check mine one moment, and then I can help you out. I didn't get any errors. Always look at your output panel just in case you get any problems. And then, so I'm going to test it on mine here. I'm going to go past the start screen. I open up my gate. I pick up the rock and I put it on the window. It detects it. It detected it. And then it goes on to the next scene, happy face. So we'll fix that one up in a moment, and here's our code so far. Yes, I heard, just one moment. So there you go, make sure that it is able to detect your window, and then we're moving on to the entryway.
Well,
Should break the window. I think everyone has that. Okay, let's go on. Again, if it's not quite working at a certain point, we'll try to help you. But remember, I'll give you my code at the end of the day so you can look at your code yourself. And remember, we have the lab time. So, you know, it's nice to leave early and such, but if it's not working, definitely stay to check my code and your code to confirm it. So all of this code, what it was doing hit detection. So when you do your version of the game, you're going to do something very similar. You're going to drag some object, start drag. You're going to stop dragging in some object, stop drag. And then you're going to do a test. You're going to do an if to test. Did this thing touch that thing? So thinking about it in your game eventually. Well, I'm going to pick up this key and put it into this keyhole. Same sort of thing. You make a symbol of a key, you give it an instance name, you set up the code, and then hit detection. keyMC.hitDetect door. And it will detect if the key touched the door. So all of this is then to play the movie clip of the window. And the movie clip of the window, frame 50, is what actually takes us to the entryway. So we've got navigation in the movie clip, but we don't trigger it until we have one thing touch another thing. So let's go back to our scene 4 and start to draw an entryway. An entry with a couple of hallways where we can branch off. So go to your scene 4 entry. I'm going to draw a hallway. So if you played the example game, for fun, what I did was, you know, I've got, something that looks like this. We walked right into the door.
There's a wall right ahead of us. There's a hallway that goes off over there. Over there. You could set it up that you've got two doors. You know, a wall and two doors. Or three doors. You can be as complex as you want when you draw your own, when you make your own project. But then what I did at this point is, in the example game, there's a painting on the wall that is one of these examples of things that don't really do anything. Now, people were saying, well, what if, you know, because you get killed in the example very easily, and someone said, well, what if you have to first touch the painting before you can open the other door? That's something that we might think about doing. But what I'm getting at is, if you played the game, there's a painting here. You touch the painting, it kind of moves. You touch it again, and then it falls down. So let's do that. Let's do an example of a movie clip that behaves in different ways the different times that you touch it. I'm going to draw a picture hanging on the door, on the wall here. It's too big. I'm going to draw a picture. It's hanging by a little string, nailed right there. I made it funny by having a smiley face, but then when you knock it down, it gets a sad face. There's a family photo there. Anything that we need to interact with then needs to become a symbol. So draw your picture and then symbolize it, turn it into a symbol. This will be MC painting. In the library, it's MC painting. In the instance name, what is it? Painting MC. This is an example where I do want to edit the symbol in context. If you double-click it in the library, it's out of context. It only focuses on the symbol. I want to focus on it here because I'm going to draw it so that eventually the painting falls down and breaks on the floor. If we do it in the library, we can't tell where the floor is at. So here on the stage, I'll double-click it to edit it. And now I can see, okay, when it's going to fall, I see the floor. I see where the painting is going to break. So while I'm editing it here, I'll fill in my colors. I'm being very simple with just black and white. Obviously, you'll want to do real colors later. Or if you want to get really artistic and do it all in black and white, that'd be fine. Remember, we had an example of one movie on our project too, which was all in black and white and was really nice. So we've got... our first frame here. First frame, name that into assets, of course. New layer, actions. I'll be very careful here when we're creating these layers. Make sure you're in the right element. We're doing this, of course, inside the painting, not back on the main timeline. We need a stop action. We need a stop command on frame one of our actions layer in the painting. So I'm inside of the painting. Actions frame one. The way this will work is if a person, a person's going to have the instinct of, I see a painting, let me touch it. So they'll tap it and then they're going to wiggle it a moment. So, let me do that again. They tap it and then the second time it'll fall. So we need a way to keep track of that. How many times has the person tapped it? When they've tapped it twice, three times, whatever, then it falls.
I walk into a room and say, hey, you can knock that down.
Well, when I play games, I know I touch everything. I might find something.
Yeah. You don't walk into a room and say, hey, that's a nice face. Oh, thanks.
Well, not in the real world, but in a computer world, I'm going to knock that vase down. There's something inside of it.
You touch everything and you go everywhere.
Exactly.
Yes. Everywhere and touch everything.
Yeah.
That's right.
And open everything.
And the most isolated areas normally hold the best treasure.
Exactly. So hopefully I find some of that stuff from you guys in your games. Diego.
Yeah, Which thing are we in? Are we in the...
Yeah,
in the
main.
Yes.
So, to keep track of how many times we touch it, would that be in the else?
It will be in your house again, yeah. But we need now also a variable to keep track of.
Wait, did you draw one thing in the inside the layers of the painting?
No, just the painting.
No, there's no extra...
Nope, just the painting.
You just filled it in so it had more area.
All right, so in order for us to check how many times did the person tap this, we want them to tap it at least once or twice or something. We need to keep track of how many number of taps. This is going to be a variable. Remember, a variable is a container to keep track of something. So after your stop, we're first going to set this up. Var MC painting tug counter. Or tap counter, whatever. How many times did they tug on the painting? How many times did they touch the painting? No space right there, colon, number, capital N. This is a container that will keep track of the number of times we've tugged on the painting. So it's a container. It has a type of number equal to 1. When we tap it one time, it's then going to be, okay, you've tapped it more than once. So we assume at least one tap right here. The next frame, frame 5, on your assets layer, press F6 to copy. Actually, the way we'll do it is we'll do an F7. F7 on your assets layer, and then we need to turn on onion skinning.
Because it's going to be, the painting is untouched, frame 1. The painting is touched, which will, I'll make it move a little bit. So F7 with onion skin. So I can see where the painting was, so I can redraw it, moved a little bit.
So frame 5, F7, and then draw the painting, moved a little bit.
Down or?
Exactly, I'm going to move it down, because I'm trying to like grab it, and it's moving down a little. So the way I'll draw that is, you know, move it down a little bit. Now the painting, I don't have to trace it exactly, that's not my point. I'm moving it down a little bit, and then I'm also kind of pulling the string a little bit lower, because it moved. And then again, it's going to be super subtle, but one way to keep them trying to tap it is, I'm also going to change the expression on the painting a little bit. Because then they'll say, what was that? And then they tap it again, and then it falls. So I'm redrawing it, redrawing the little guy over here. So,
question mark. Yeah.
So on frame 1, the painting is normal. They tap it one time, the painting will be tugged down a little bit, the expression changes. This is then when I'm going to keep track of, oh, they've tapped it another time. Before that, I'm going to fill in these colors. Now, didn't we used to be able to press X and we swap our colors?
Yeah. I think
Adobe.
Lines probably.
Adobe gives and Adobe takes.
Uh-huh.
We can probably remap them in the options, but that's one of the things I miss right away. Swapping colors, so simple. Why did they take it away?
They probably rebound it to something else, like Alt X or something weird like that.
Yeah. Okay, so frame 1, it's a normal painting. Frame 5, the painting's been moved. On your actions layer, we also need an F7 there, because then we need to do some code here. We need to check. This is the part where we check. Did the person tap the painting enough times to knock it down? Not yet. We want them to try to tap it one more time. So F7 on your actions layer, and let's open your actions panel. We have MC painting tug counter plus plus. We forgot to comment the previous code. We'll do that in a moment. But what this one does is add one more to the tug counter. We started with one. At this point, we tapped the painting. We added one more. Then we have two. Not in this case. When we called it back over here, when we did var MC painting tug, that's what we called it. Where this is not. When it's not underscore MC because we're not dealing with an instance name. We're dealing with the name of a variable.
So in frame one, it's not supposed to be underscore.
You could, but you just have to be consistent with your code. I'm not putting underscore, so I recommend not. Add one more to the tug counter. And now here's where we can make that decision. We had the decision previously. If you move your rock to the window, do something. Now, if we touch the painting 10 times, now it falls. So we'll have if, else, if MC painting, tug counter, space greater than 3. If you touch the painting more than 3 times, then it falls. Because someone might not quite notice it the first time. That's why I'm changing the expression on the painting. They might tap it quickly, something happened, let me tap it again. Oh, that's fun, let me tap it again, and then it falls, it breaks. So, obviously I can put any number of numbers here, but if it's too high, a person's never going to think about touching it 10 times. Maybe. I don't know. Some people are, you know, find all of these interesting things in a game by trying every single thing. So here, all that we really wanted to do is go to the next frame of animation, which is it broken on the floor. We haven't drawn that yet. But that's going to be go to and play frame 10 of the current animation. Inside of the painting. Frame 1 is the painting normal. Frame 5 is the painting moved. Frame 10 will be the painting broken. So once we've touched the painting more than 3 times, it plays to the 10th frame, broken painting. If if it's not enough times to break it yet, well, we need to go back to the first frame to put the painting back to normal. So, or else, go to and play frame 1. Frame 10 is where it shows it broken. Show the broken picture on frame 10. If they touch the painting more than 3 times, show the broken picture on frame 10. If they haven't touched enough times, loop back to frame 1, the normal painting. The untouched painting. So this concept right here, you can take it one step further to see so many things. You can take it that, you know, you have to accomplish a certain number of things. This door will not open until something else happens. You have to go from this room back to another room before some other door is open. This is the logic that happens in a video game when you need to go pick up that key to open up a room in a different cave. Well, there's some counter that's keeping track of something. And once the counter reaches something, right here we're using greater than. So right now, we've tugged on it once. Is one more than three? No. So it does the else portion. And then we increment it. Is two more than three? No. So it jumps back again to play one more time. The third time, is three more than three? No, three is equal to three. So it goes back to else again. Okay, the fourth time, is four greater than three? Yes, so then we hit the next animation. If we want it to be three, if we want it to be three or more, that's different than this. This is saying more than three. If we want it to be three or more, we do equals greater than. We're not going to do that one. I think we're fine without it. But if we also want to include three or more clicks, it's greater than equals. That means four or more, not including three. We need to then draw frame 10, where the painting is broken. So on your assets layer, we go to frame 10, F7, turn on onion skinning. And the point of that is, oh well, we need to be back on I need to see that. So I have the original background, F7 on frame 10. Now I know where to have it fall. I'm going to draw the painting now, somewhere fallen on the floor, either fully fallen or bent or something. And I can see where it should hit the floor, because I'm editing and I have onion skin. I'm going to draw this.
Sad, broken picture.
There's the twine all broken up. It's broken over here. The little guy is dead. There's glass on the floor. Fill that in with color. Get those shards if I really, really want, doesn't matter. Does not matter at all. So it's broken there.
Now, obviously, this is going to automatically loop around back to the beginning, so we need to add a stop command on frame 10. Because we've said, okay, the painting has not been touched, we touch it one time, so it jumps and plays one of the movements, loops back. Eventually, it's going to break, so it's going to then go to and play 10, go to and play 10, so then that'll loop back to the beginning. No, I want that once it falls, I can't tap it anymore, so on that frame 10, we'll stop.
F7 frame 10 on the actions layer. So that at this point the painting is no longer tapped. The painting now is on the floor broken. Which then we need to stop we need to stop the ability to keep clicking on it. Just because it fell on the floor doesn't mean the coding is done. It fell. But the code is still there to try to keep tapping it, to try to keep making it fall. Well, it's already on the floor. So then we need to deactivate the ability for us to keep tapping on it. Once we've hit that frame, we shouldn't tap it anymore, so let's deactivate that. We have to say movie clip. Parentheses this dot root painting MC. In this case, the underscore is here because we're dealing with the instance of the painting. A moment ago, we didn't have the underscore because it was a variable to keep track of the number of tugs. Dot remove event listener. This is a new one. We've dealt with event listeners. Add event listeners. And now here's a remove. Add event listener is basically start paying attention to tapping on this thing. But once we've broken the painting, we should stop trying to tap the painting. It's broken. So we're going to say remove the ability to keep tapping the painting. We have inside parentheses touch event dot touch tap. Comma, again, the movie clip root code. Movie clip this dot root. This is a little tricky, I'll zoom out in a moment. Dot FN painting fall. So here we're setting it up so that no longer let us tap the painting. This is a function that we haven't created yet. But we're saying, once it gets to frame 10, stop the ability to tap it. And deactivate the painting fall function, which we're going to write in a moment. But this is what we have on this frame. Let me back that again because it's a long one. Movie clip, this root, dot, painting MC. Remove event listener instead of add remove. In the parentheses, touch.event, touch tap, comma. This would be what is the function we're going to add if it was an event, if it was an add event, add listener. In our case, it's a remove. So we're saying we're going to remove this function. No longer let us tap on the painting. So frame 1, that's got to stop with a counter. Frame 5, it's got increase the counter and check if we're on the right condition. And then frame 10, stop the animation and remove the touch ability. On screen, we've got the painting normal. Then we've got the painting moved a little bit. Then we've got the painting broken. For all of this to work, we need to then add the event listener to touch the painting on the regular scene, scene 4. I'm going to copy, just so I don't retype it, that name right there. We'll go back to the scene 4 entry, and then in the actions layer, we need to set up the ability to actually tap it. Just one moment. We were adding the code to do something about the painting, but now we actually add the code to actually move it or touch it. So go to your actions layer. This is back on your scene 4, and back to your actions layer, and here we will add painting MC dot add event listener. Touch event dot touch tap dot or comma function painting fall. This is what a moment ago we were deactivating it. We kind of did it backwards. Oftentimes we set up an event listener to do something, add event listener. And then we sometimes then deactivate an event listener. We did it backwards. We set up the deactivation first and then the activation. Didn't really matter. We did it in that order because it'll work once it actually runs. Next line, we have to define what that function is. So event touch event. Void. Painting MC play. This looks pretty much the same as the gate and the front door. We're making the movie clip play. But in the movie clip, we've set up this cool functionality. It's going to play as in it goes up to the frame where it gets moved. It increments the counter. It checks the results. It's not enough taps, so it jumps back to let us tap it again. Eventually, we've tapped it enough times that it checks. Tug counter greater than 3, then it jumps to frame 10. And on frame 10, the painting has fallen, and we're no longer able to tap the painting. This should be enough here. Let's pause here, save it, and run it. See if that works. You should be able to tap the painting, and it moves. Let me run it really fast on my Control Enter, and then we'll check people's code. Let me just confirm mine. It's always a good idea that my code works before I help people. So we start, we go past the gate, pick up the rock and toss it, breaks it. We'll add sound effects later. It goes to the hallway. I tap the painting once.
Yeah, I think he didn't have anything to advance to frame 5.
Huh. But we have play. That's what this is supposed to do here. Let the movie clip play from 1 and let it play to 5. You know what? I think I remember. It's going too fast. It is doing it, but it's going too fast.
Was this supposed to be said at the end of...
We can pause one moment while I figure this out. So, this might be happening way too fast. It may be checking this and it goes back too fast to frame 1. Maybe it's better for this to be on the next frame. Let me check that. Oh, actually, wait. I've got to go to and play on a frame 7 in my notes. Oh yeah, there it is. Okay. And then it needs to fall. Okay, I've got it here. The moral of the story is, if you have notes, follow your notes. So here's what we needed to do. Let's back up a little bit here. Let's go back to edit the painting movie clip one more time. I forgot something here.
Okay, the right parentheses and the semicolon.
Okay, so what we've got here is back on frame 5. Of the painting. This go to a glaze in the wrong spot. It's looping too fast. So this go to a glaze needs to be on frame 6 or 7. Because this needs to happen first before we loop. We're looping it too fast. ActionScript runs so fast that it's doing it too fast. So we're gonna cut. We're gonna move. We're gonna cut the go to and play and make a new frame 7. And paste go to and play on frame 7. So cut go to and play 1, cut it out of frame 5. Let's make a new F7 frame 7. Let's paste it there. And change it to go to and stop frame 1. That it's again, it's looping too much. So we need to give it a moment for it to loop back to to frame one.
Now we should try and publish it.
Yes, let me confirm my code and then we'll help people. As you test this, you might then see the repetition of some things, which then helps you figure out what you should do. So it moves. Still not incrementing. Let me check my spelling here. So painting tug counter, and then we've got it here, painting tug counter. That is increasing it. Painting tug counter greater than 3. Go to and play 10. Frame 10. There's our stop. Doesn't seem to be getting to the stop. We've got our remove.
What if you switch those two around?
So the order of this code does matter, but in that case it shouldn't. My notes don't have it switched because we do want things to stop visually, but then we want it to deactivate the event listener. Yes.
I think it's because on frame one on the MC painting, we redefined the MC painting counter number equals to 1 again. So even though it's
That's true. We redefine it.
You could set it to frame 2.
Yeah, that's what I did.
You know what, you're exactly right. That's what I have in my notes. Again, I should pay attention to my own notes. But thank you for that. Okay, so here's what's missing. We're saying, on frame 7, go back to frame 1.
Well, frame 1 is where we create the variable for the first time, so we're recreating the variable every time.
Whoops, we don't want that. We want it to loop back to frame 2, where we are not recreating the variable. So you see that when we told it to go back to frame 1, we said, okay, great, create the variable again, and we set it to 1 again. Whoops. Okay, well, on frame 7, let's go back to frame 2 and stop so that we don't recreate the variable. Then if the person taps, it goes back to 5. We increment it to the next counter, and then it can start to check. Yeah, exactly. There's so many ways to keep doing it. Once we get more complex, we can find smarter ways. That is a smarter way here. As beginners, maybe this might be a more straightforward way, but we can definitely refine this code as we go on. So, thank you for that. Let me check my code. That should be it. So, once you start to test this and you've got 40 different screens you've made, you're going to have to walk through your own game 40 times. Okay, tap it once. Oops, it moved. Tap it again. Oh, that's fun. And then, oops, I broke it. So then I can't tap it anymore. I shouldn't be able to tap it anymore because the event listener was removed. Remove event listener. So I tapped it a certain time. Maybe it's too many taps. Maybe a person loses interest after one tap. So we just decrease the number. Greater than 2. Then it'll be tapped less times until it breaks. So this is one of these misdirections. In my case, in my example, this does nothing at all in the game. In your example, this could be something for you that once I've uncovered the painting, oh, there's a key behind it. And then we've got a key that we can pick up, and we'll talk about how to do that a little later. Let me pause right here. This is what it should do. You should knock down the painting eventually. Anyone need a little help with that? Yes, let me... Yes, scene 4 is, let me go back to scene 4. Scene 4 is the, right here, to get the painting to start to react.
Right, thank you.
And you've been now,
past the curly brace before end of the program. So, double click on that.
Alright, so are we good? Anyone need a little help at this point? Everyone has this working at this point? We'll do one more thing, then we'll wrap up. So we'll go until 12:30, and then we'll have lab time. One more thing is, well, this is a misdirection. At the moment, the painting doesn't do anything. We have a hallway, left and right. So we'll set up to go to the hallway to the right, which is an instant death. We can, of course, make it do other things. But let's set it up that as soon as you go to the right, you see a monster, you're petrified in terror, you're dead. Yes.
Why not put a message right behind the painting then, so we can do something?
We can definitely do that. We'll come back to that idea later, but we can definitely do that. Once you've interacted with something, something else can happen. We'll get back to that.
I was
going to
say for the death thing, say, go left, you won't die. Or trick you to say, yeah, you should go right.
You should go right, yeah. Yeah, that's something that you can easily do in your movie clip. Just draw that text on the frame where the painting is broken on the floor. Draw that message right behind where the painting was. All right, so what we need to do here then is have a way to move to the right. We've been seeing that everything we want a reaction from needs to be a movie clip. This is an example where we can create a movie clip that could be invisible, because a person may want to tap right here. I want to go to the right, so I tap here. But we made our target to be tappable here. So we can make an invisible target that is clickable here. First, I'm going to make it as a very simple, visible shape, and then later we can change its transparency so it's invisible. Right now, everything that I can edit is obviously visible, or everything that I can click on is obviously clickable. But here, a person may click here, a person may click here. I want to make the whole area clickable. For the moment, I'm going to make a new layer. I've called this assets, but I'm going to make a new layer and call it hallways. The point of this is that I've got like the main background drawn on its own layer, and then I've got the areas where I'm going to be able to click on right hallway, left hallway on a different layer. I'm just separating them because I'm going to make an object that I want separate from the rest of the scene. And super simple, I'm going to draw a rectangle. Nothing fancy, but a tall rectangle. No stroke. White color for the moment. It's going to look obvious and ugly. But clicking anywhere on the right side will activate the ability to go to the right hallway. We'll do the left hallway similar next time. But that then needs to be a symbol. It's separate on its own layer so that this doesn't blend into the other pieces of my design. Question?
Yeah, I'm brainstorming for some computations.
Skip your code for the moment so we don't fall behind, and let's do this part. So let's turn this into a symbol. F8, and I'm going to call it MC hallway right. And then an instance name, hallway right MC. So I have something that will activate a click to take me to the right. And in a little bit, we can change its color effect to be transparent. The cool thing is that things may be transparent, but they'll still be clickable. When that's very obvious, click here, you'll go to the right. So changing the color effect to some target will be extra sneaky, because then you can put things on the screen that aren't obviously clickable that can be clicked. Under color effect, and we'll come back to it, but color effect alpha. We'll come back to it. So we've got a symbol on the screen. We need an action to activate that. So back to your actions on your S4. And we need something exactly like this. Event listener plus a function. I'm going to copy that and then just change the details. The details are, this is now hallway right MC. It will activate a function. Function go hallway right, which we define here. Function go hallway right. Function go hallway right. So I took my starting point of that stuff happening to then do moving to the right. We'll do something similar, hallway to the left next time. And what needs to happen here is exactly the same code that we had before to go from scene to scene. Well, I don't have it memorized, but I wrote it on a previous frame. So let me go find it elsewhere. To go find your code where we've got from going from scene to scene. At a certain point, I cannot tell you exactly what to do. You have to think about what you've done. You have to take one step outside the box to make your code work, because obviously we're here to help you during our class time, but then you should be doing this stuff on your own too. Try it at home, in the library, in the rooms here, and if there's no one to help you, check the code you've already done, and that's often going to give you a hint of what you need to do next. So I won't tell you exactly. You can figure it out. Go get your code from before and paste it into our current frame.
Also, students can get help from us on Discord.
Oh, you guys are so high tech now. When back in my day, it wasn't Nope, because we're gonna, like I'm saying, we can always go back to our code in a moment. We're gonna do lab time in just a moment. What scene are we on now? 5. So we're gonna make a scene 5 in a moment. Scene 5, hallway right. So this is nothing new. This is simply make something clickable, do something. The something is moved to another scene. We've done this several times. So we need a new scene. S5, hallway right. I'm just going to put like a scary skeleton there for the moment, and the next time we'll actually have it kill us.
Oh.
Or maybe, what is it called? No, it'll have us faint. That's what I meant. We'll faint.
KO.
It'll KO us. So new frame, or new scene, S5, hallway right. And on this new scene, I'll put some scary skeleton or something. And we need our stop command. So we've got a scene here where instant death. We'll fill that shit out later, but at this point, we should have the ability to then to go from the entryway scene to the scene 5 hallway to the right. And we'll stop there. I'll save it, I'll test it if it works. I'll put my code in the folder, and then we'll do lab time until 1. Remember, I'm going to give you all my code at the end of the day. This is often the best way to troubleshoot your problem. Check my code, check your code. Let me confirm mine. Start, open the gate, break the window, go to the right, dead. I don't have a back button, I don't have a start over button, I don't have any of that. You have the knowledge to set that up yourself. You can if you want to, but we will do that in a little bit. What's going to happen in the hallway is more than simply a death. We're going to have an animation where it comes out of the window and it pulls you down to the depths or something. I don't know. We're going to have something happen, then it'll take us to a real final game over scene. We want to have music and sound effects. We're going to do that, of course. But for this point, we'll end at this point. And if you're publishing it onto your real device, it's pretty impressive to show your friends and family, look at the game I'm working on, and show them on your real device and have them play. Beta test it. Help you beta test it. You might get good ideas for your own version. Like we were saying here, it might be fun to do something about that painting, you know, after we've touched it a few times and we break it, maybe a message appears behind it. Maybe a key appears behind it. And that key will help us on this scene over here. In the example game, if you haven't played it, when you go to the right, eventually a monster comes at you and you're so scared you die. But you could perhaps set it up that there's a weapon behind the painting there, and once you see the monster on the death screen, you use the weapon and you live. So there's the possibilities are endless. So any general conceptual questions in general, not specifics, any general questions about what we've talked about today so far? All right, let me ask you all a quick question. How many of you are kind of liking this? Raise your hand. Are you liking making your code and your game? Good amount of people. How many of you, and you can be honest, how many of you are hating this? A few people, okay, no problem. You might not, you know, want to pursue the actual hardcore coding of it, and that's fine. There's so many things that can be done in this realm. The drawing part, the coding part, the music part, the planning part in the world of game and app design. So we're going to continue to do this coding. Remember to check the YouTube videos, check the Discord screenshots. I'm about to give you all my code right now and ask us for help. That's it for the moment, and I'll see you on next week. We're already done this week, huh?